Hi, everyone. Welcome to BIEB 152. This is lecture number two. Okay, so each lecture, I want to start by taking the temperature of the epidemic. So this is where I go over a few slides, updating you on how it's proceeding, whether or not our interventions are working, whether or not there's hopeful news or maybe bad news. And so we'll do that, and then we'll move on to the actual course content. Okay, this is an update of the data that I showed you last time. I wasn't gonna show this because it's just gonna look more of the same. This phylogeny here, this evolutionary relationship of SARS-CoV-2 is gonna probably remain very robust. There's so much data that's put into this phylogeny that I don't anticipate that the patterns will change much. And certainly the patterns to the right of the spread of the disease around the world, it's spread, it's everywhere. Now it's sort of mounting in endemic infections in each of the countries. But I did want to go back to this data because I got an email asking about this idea that UCSD, it appears, hasn't been hit as hard as other places. And people are wondering that they had a really bad cold in the fall. And was that actually some sort of precursor to the current strain of SARS? And did that give them immunity to SARS-CoV-2? And I want to say that I don't believe in that theory, and that it is hopeful that this idea that maybe somehow in San Diego we were pre-exposed to this pathogen and we've developed immunity. And why I'm worried about that kind of thinking spreading is it's good to be hopeful, but not so hopeful that we begin to influence our own behaviors and stop doing things like social distancing. And so the reason why I don't think that theory holds is this data here. And so if you see on this x-axis here, this is these are dates in which certain strains were isolated and sequenced. And then they're using evolutionary biology and phylogenetic reconstruction to be able to predict when the strain probably emerged from bats to humans. And it certainly emerged, or all of the data suggests that emerged in early December, and that was in Wuhan. So it was confined to a region of the world. And then from there, it spread out. And we have so much data now that suggests that I just don't think that that's actually going to change. So there's also, a lot of theories about, was this in Italy first? No, the data does not suggest that. Other theories are that this was a lab strain. The data we'll look at later in this lecture and later in the course suggests that this is certainly not a lab strain, that this looks like a natural variant that's very similar to variants that we've seen in bats and sampled, a couple years ago. So it's not a lab strain. It emerged in Wuhan and spread around the world after that. Okay, I'm gonna keep moving. So this is more about checking the temperature of what's going on. This is a plot that I showed you last time, and I had fit this little curve here optimistically, hoping that we were no longer in the exponential increase phase of spread within the United States. But when we look at the, sorry, I have to move the window. When we look at the data from 2 days ago and from today, we find that, my fit to the curve was overly optimistic. The rate of increase of the spread within the United States is still increasing. It does appear to be slowing down, but of course, just a few data points don't really make a trend. We have to see more data and see how this unfolds. Certainly the CDC is predicting that in the next couple weeks nationwide, that's when it's going to be the worst for the United States. But remember, we are states and we all have different behaviors in each state, in different economies and different cultures. And so in different times in which we got the disease. And so it's probably a state-by-state basis in which you're going to see this sort of peak and then hopefully dropping back down. It looks like that is what happened already in Washington. I would say that New York is probably at the peak stage now and will be dropping. And then in the future, it'll sort of cycle through other states as well. So remember to remain social distancing. It's the best thing that we can do right now. Okay, and I showed you this confusing plot last time, and I wasn't going to show it again because, you know, these lines are all over the place. That y-axis is complicated. That y-axis, I will explain the math behind it in three lectures when we talk about natural selection and I go over exponential growth. For now, just know that higher values are bad, lower values are good, and that if you have a flat line in this graph, that means that you're still in exponential expansion of the disease. And so what's kind of good news for the world is that in all of these different countries, the trajectory is downwards rather than flat. And that means that they're leaving the exponential expansion phase of the disease, and it's hopefully grinding down and won't be as big of a problem in the near future. But the US, you can see, is kind of all over the place. This is because we're a giant country and there's probably different kinds of dynamics happening within each state. And so it's hard to just look at this sort of combined data. But it also reminds us, and we're barely deviating at all from exponential growth. And so it reminds us that we have to remain vigilant on social distancing and other practices. The CDC is contemplating using face masks now for the general public as a precaution and as a way to limit the spread. And I would say don't use masks that are the ones that should be used in the hospital. We should give them to the people in the hospital. But there are lots of ways to make your own mask at home that are relatively effective. And so I do suggest doing that. I haven't actually worn a mask outside yet, but I think we should sort of break the kind of social barrier and acceptability of wearing masks in the United States and maybe start doing that. Okay, and this is data that I showed last time, but this is an update on it. And what we can see here is that this is the temperature data from the smart thermometers that are spread throughout the United States by Kinsa Healthcare. And here are some plots, and they just show that COVID-19 was causing these atypical patterns. And now that once we started social distancing, now we've actually dropped below what they expected would be the normal level of sick people based on temperature across the United States. So social distancing is having a real effect. This is the data that shows it. And so we just need to keep on social distancing. Okay, so let's keep moving forward. The other data I showed is kind of bad data. It seems that we're still in the exponential expansion phase in the United States, in most of the states. So I wanted to share some good information, and this is a little bit old compared to a lot of the information that I've been sharing. But basically, the NIH has started a clinical trial of a COVID-19 vaccine. All over the world, people are coming together to develop these vaccines. There's trials either starting or have started in other countries in the world. But this is very promising, and hopefully we can have a vaccine and just sort of forget about SARS-CoV-2. I have this picture here. That's just a model of the virus itself. And then it has these red protrusions, and that's this structure, this protein here, are those red protrusions. That's the S protein, that's the host recognition protein. This is highlighted because this is likely the feature that they're using to put in the vaccine to elicit immunological response from our own bodies to become immune from this viral particle. The vaccine is being carried out by this collaborative effort, which is amazing. I can't even imagine putting all of these pieces together, but you have Kaiser Healthcare. They have hospitals in all over the West Coast especially, but in Washington, where they're doing this clinical trial, you have the NIH through one of their, the NIAID, funding the science, and also scientists that are associated with them doing the research. You have Moderna, which is a company in Massachusetts and Cambridge, and they're helping the development with their scientists. And then you have this Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations in Norway that's actually manufacturing some of the vaccine. So it is, it's this collaborative effort. But I have to say that it's more than just this one group and this one collaboration. In the New York Times, just yesterday, they're pointing out that scientists are working together across the world, whether they're in the public sector like I am, or in the private sector at places like Moderna. They're working together, sharing data, and it's a great thing. There was news that Trump tried to get a company from Germany to move over here so that we would have the rights, I guess, to the vaccine, or maybe not the rights, but control over the vaccine. And China also proposed a similar kind of deal with another company in Germany. And so it seems that our politicians are sort of gonna fight over this vaccine, but at least the scientists are not engaged in that. So hopefully there'll be enough for everybody, and we'll get over this soon. What's the timeline for vaccine testing? At least a year. So it's gonna take a long time. We have to continue social distancing and other practices.